podcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for frame rate is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Frame Rate is brought to you by Squarespace.com, the fast and easy way to create a high-quality website or blog. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase on new accounts, go to Squarespace.com and use offer code FRAMERATE6. And they now offer free domain registration with annual plan subscriptions. And by Netflix. Watch thousands of TV episodes and movies on your PC, Mac, iPad, iPhone, or TV instantly. All stream directly to you, saving you time, money, and hassle. For your free 30-day trial, go to netflix.com/twit.
Jack Austin, astronaut, exposed to inappropriate levels of solar energy.
Sunlight makes him the world's smartest man.
I know everything!
I want that brain. Take it out.
Heat Vision, the motorcycle with the mind of Jack's unemployed roommate. Together they run for their lives, blocked at every turn by adventure.
Now let's just power for real.
Go, 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 go!
It's Frame Rate. Ha, ha, ha. You thought you were getting something else, but you're getting Frame Rate instead.
Yeah, in your face. You thought you'd get, like, smart content about tech. Instead, you get me and Tom talking about, I don't know, movies, TV.
With frame rate rolled, you cord cutters.
I like frame rate rolling. That's a good one.
Welcome to Frame Rate, the show where we talk about how you get the television movies you want without having to be inconvenienced by walking or paying for things you don't want to pay for. It's the cord cutting show.
Well, here's the thing. We originally wanted to call the show Greedy Bastards, but we realized that's bad SEO. So we called it Frame Rate.
Yeah, because we do rate the frames on set-top boxes, on streaming services, on stuff you can watch on the internet, high quality to low quality, including Heat Vision.
We sit in judgment of the frames. Yeah, by the way, that intro title sequence was from a pilot in, what, 1998, 1999? Ben Stiller directed, Jack Black starring, plus the voice of Owen Wilson as a talking motorcycle, which, by the way, is it ironic, Tom, that he went on to be a talking car in Cars?
No, that's just coincidental, Brian.
Okay. All right. I'm just checking on that. Anyway, I wonder, like, what a different world it would have been if this was picked up and instead all of them went on to be super famous movie people.
Yeah. I don't think that you would be able to afford to license these people to do this now. It's sad.
No, that is true.
Hire. Copyright world we live in has turned everything into a license somehow.
That's right. They're just intellectual properties. It's just IP.
Just made of IP. We are not matter. We are intellectual property beings.
No, we are luminous intellectual properties, not these crude matter.
All right, let's move on to the big story.
Zah.
This just in, the big story.
Brian, our day has come.
Oh, thank goodness, because I was waiting for our day. And it was always other people's days. I didn't know ours was sneaking up on us.
Our day is finally here. E3, everybody thinks, oh, it's a video game convention. But do you know what the three E's in E3 are?
Electronic Entertainment Evacuations?
Nah, close. You got two out of three. Expo is the last one. Now, we're still waiting for the Montreal Expos to get their due. But finally, entertainment is front and center at E3.
Yeah, man. I thought this was really interesting. I did not. You know me. I mean, I'm the kind of guy who would fall in love with hardcore gaming announcements. But these non-video game related announcements are something that I've been pulling for with Xbox from the very beginning. What exactly happened, Tom? Walk us through it.
So Microsoft, obviously, they're showing lots of video games at E3. But Microsoft doubling down on video, their big announcement was focusing on software updates to the Xbox that are going to provide more content. So ESPN expands their app to give you more live sports and more content from ESPN2 and more editions of SportsCenter, et cetera, et cetera. You're going to get the NBA, you're going to get NHL, and that's the thing everybody complains about. I want to cut the cord, but how do I get the sports? Well, there's more sports going to be added to the Xbox now if you're into that sort of thing. Also, Univision, Paramount, Machinima, all announcing additions to the service. They announced something called Xbox Music, which, as far as I can tell, seems to be Microsoft's Zune marketplace service, now repackaged, cleaned up a little, and renamed Xbox Music. But the big thing is smart glass. Smart glass being this new way that you can kind of sling video from your smartphone or your tablet to the Xbox. Kind of like AirPlay works on Apple. You can use it as an additional controller for video games. You can use it to see additional content about the video you're watching on your Xbox. And it acts as a keyboard for the browser. There's Internet Explorer now on Xbox. So Xbox saying, look, yeah, we're for video games, for sure. But we're going to be your home entertainment center. That's what we want to be. And if you're like, yeah, okay, but I don't want to have to buy a Windows phone or a Windows tablet to take advantage of that, smart glass is going to work with iOS and Android, according to Microsoft.
So is there any truth to the rumors that Xbox is going to promote smart glass by suggesting that whatever your content is, put them on the glass?
Whatever your content is, put them on the glass.
Yeah, is there any rumor to that?
I don't think that's true. No.
You don't know. All right, this is Sir Mix-a-Lot joke. Listen, here's the thing. This is very smart on their behalf, because as much as I love using my Xbox as a primary entertainment console, there are certain limitations that drive me nuts. And I did not watch this announcement live, so I'm going to need you to answer on behalf of Microsoft if you can. So you said that you can use your smartphone or tablet as a keyboard, right?
For Internet Explorer, yeah.
For Internet Explorer, or just for all the devices?
Because well, here's the problem, Brian. You're like, I want you to answer on behalf of Microsoft accurate and true answers for everything they've ever said in their lives. And the fact of the matter is, I don't know all the answers to these things. They didn't show you every in and out. There's still questions about, will I need to authenticate as a cable subscriber to get all of the ESPN content, or can I just run the app? Blackout situation still going to apply to NBA and NHL? We don't know. There's lots of stuff we don't know.
Right. Well, and we also saw, and I thought this was curious, because everyone's like, obviously part of this move is to steal the thunder from Nintendo's Wii U. But the problem is it's not sufficient just to have some kind of screen and some kind of controls, because the part of what makes the Wii U novel is and usable is the fact that you're able to do controls and glance down and see stuff, whereas it's fundamentally different to have some controls and then look over and pick up your phone and check your health bar stats or whatever, or select your play.
Okay, I can't answer that. If you're playing video games, which is right, kind of beside the point for this show, but when you're playing video games, you will be using the controller or the phone or / tablet. You will not have to use both of them at the same time.
Okay. All right. Well, I mean, I guess it makes sense, but switching back and forth would be a problem. But I'm sure, I mean, that's...
As far as video game playing goes, that is a difference where I think the Wii probably has an advantage because it's all in one device. But the advantage on the Xbox is I don't have to... I'm not locked to using the controller, that I may only have one of them and I may have to pay a bunch extra. I can just bring whatever phone I have in my pocket. Boom. I have something to use. And I'm less interested in how it's going to be used for video games. I'm more interested in how it's going to be used for TV and video, for streaming video, because I do use my tablet that way to like look up things on IMDb and find out more information. But I've tried a couple of those push apps, like Yahoo had one, Walking Dead had one, where you're watching a live broadcast and it'll give you information as you're watching it. And
right,
they, frankly,
sure,
they sync up pretty well, but I've never found them very compelling.
Right, right. Well, and there is, there doesn't exist that killer app that makes this a must-have ability. But one more thing on the video games thing. I know that's not what we're covering, but it seems to me like this additional form of interface could allow an entire genre of gaming that has never existed on the Xbox to occur with stuff like maybe finally that interface would allow you to play a real-time strategy game on a console system. But let's talk about the airplane.
Well, there have been RTSs on the Xbox before. They're just really clunky. It's really hard to use.
Correct. But let's talk about the AirPlay-like features. Is this something that could be integrated at the OS level? Because obviously on your iPhone, no matter what video you're showing, no matter what app it is, if there's an AirPlay available, you can click it and it throws it up on the screen. How are they going to translate? How are they going to get close to that with an external app on the iPhone or Android?
Yeah, that's a good question. On the non-Microsoft platforms, how does it work? I don't know yet. Again, they didn't release all the details, or at least I haven't seen all the details about how they just showed it working, and they said, we're also bringing this app to iOS and Android. But
right.
Does that mean I can take my iTunes purchased videos and send them to my Xbox? Because I doubt that Microsoft's going to be able to figure out how to do that. What
right.
I'm guessing is you could buy a video from the Xbox marketplace, from the Microsoft marketplace, have access to it on your smart glass app, and then send it to the Xbox. Although you'd probably have to be connected to the internet to watch it locally,
right?
On you know, because it's going to stream it, just like a Netflix app would stream videos.
Right. All right. Well, look, it's very exciting, and this is something that you know, you and I have gone back and forth about the Google TV, whether or not it's. I keep insisting that I'm afraid it's underpowered, and that I would prefer to use my Xbox 360. And it seems like Xbox 360 is realizing that they're sitting on a very high powered, deep penetrating device for watching video content, and I'm glad to see them taking advantage of it.
Well, we finally got Dave MacD got to the point I wanted to get to. You can do all these things with set-top boxes that cost half as much and don't require a monthly fee just to get on the web. And that's the big problem with the Xbox is you have to be an Xbox Live subscriber. Now, if you're already an Xbox Live subscriber because you play video games, then that's not a big concern for you. It's a sunk cost. But if you're looking at this as like, well, I'm making a purchase decision. Should I buy an Xbox because it's got all these great features and it's, you know, really taking on the Apple TV? Or should I get an Apple TV or should I get a Roku or a Boxy box? It's much cheaper to buy a Roku or even an Apple TV. And no. I don't have to pay a fee to use the service that lets me use the other services that I also have to pay fees for.
Well, you're 100% right in all of those things. However, I don't think that's even the angle they're going for. They don't want to convince anyone that they should buy an Xbox instead of buying a Roku box. Instead, what they want to do is say, don't bother to touch anything else but your Xbox. Join the ecosystem. Let us get you associated. Let's get you comfortable with the idea that the Xbox is how you handle all of your entertainment in the living room. Once that happens, then they've got an automatic upgrade to whatever the Xbox 720 ends up being called when it comes out. I think it's a smart play, and it doesn't make sense to seduce complete non-gamers, but I don't think that's really what they're trying to do here.
You may be right. I think they are giving a nod to that, like, hey, folks, if you don't like gaming, that's okay. Somebody in your house likes gaming. But I think you're right. If I'm, like, living alone or in a household that nobody plays video games and nobody cares about an Xbox, I don't think Microsoft's trying to convince you that the Xbox is the right thing for you. Although they probably wouldn't mind if you thought that way. I just don't think.
No. But again, I don't think they're leading off with that. They're not. They're certainly not doing any kind of campaign that we can tell to seduce non-gamers into buying an Xbox. Not that it wouldn't work. I know my parents ended up buying a PS3 because they wanted a Blu-ray player. They don't play a single game ever, and in fact, they so far they've only used it to watch Netflix on.
I think some people will do that. You know, they do have the $99 Xbox bundle that gives you the Kinect and the Xbox. It's only a 4 GB version, but that's the one that's going to play against the Roku. So I don't know, Brian. Maybe they are targeting Roku and Apple with that price point.
I guess we'll see. Yeah. I'm excited, though, regardless. It's like it's never a bad thing to have more options and more technology. It's they're going to have to work really hard, though, to get people comfortable with the idea of using there, because it's not the same. Again, with the Wii U, you open it, you plug it in, and you got a screen, and you do the thing, and everything's intuitive. This business of, all right, now you got to sync, and you got to put an app on, and you got to have a login. You have a login, right? Okay. And then, you gotta connect them like this, and you can use it for this, but you can't use it for that.
Well, but you gotta log in on the Wii. I'm not sure how you're making it sound a little more complicated than I think
What I'm saying is compared to the Wii, it is complicated. Any kind of pairing of anything that you have to install or set up and then two separate pieces of anything is light years more complicated than what's going to happen with the Wii. With the Wii, your great grandparents could take it out of the box, turn it on, and it's going to make sense.
Why isn't it on the internet? I have to put in this Wi-Fi password. That happens on the Wii.
That's the same for both consoles. But the difference is on Xbox, you're going to have on top of that using another non-Microsoft device
I can only use this device with the Wii. I want to take it with me. Just pull out the tablet. You can use it wherever you want. That's much more convenient, Grandpa.
I think that's an unfair representation of what you're being oldest right now is what I'm accusing you of.
No, I think you're being oldest by saying I can't understand a smartphone.
No, I'm not saying that at all. What I'm saying is that it matters. Out-of-the-box simplicity absolutely appeals to consumers.
Apple, have to hook up this thing? Why can't I just use the thing that I already have?
I would say Apple's stock price is in favor of my side of the argument.
You don't see Apple coming out with this big, complicated gamepad. You see him coming out with a tablet. It's easy to
use. True, but you do see them coming out with an out-of-the-box, super simple television that people can watch.
Well, actually, Nintendo's not even emphasizing the Wii U yet, and that's our next big story.
Stop everything. It's another big story.
I take that back. I misspoke. They're not even emphasizing. That was a horrible transition. They are emphasizing the Wii U.
No, it was the perfect transition because it got everyone thinking, what? What is he talking about? And now's the part where you're like, just kidding. They're totally emphasizing.
They're totally emphasizing the Wii U. But what I meant to say is they're not emphasizing just video games. They are also emphasizing video. Netflix, Hulu, Amazon Video, and YouTube all coming to the Wii U. That was just announced minutes ago by Reggie Fils-Aime, the Nintendo keynote speaker. Further details is still yet to come because it's breaking right now. And, of course, you have to wait for the Wii U to arrive. But I think they are trying to say to people, we are the same. We are that same thing. We are that home entertainment center also. But we're a lot easier to use. And to Brian's point, you know, we've got that gamepad that's awesome. And you don't have to bring your own phone or your tablet.
Couple of things. First of all, I think the big winner here is Amazon for even being included in this announcement. You know, I sort of think of them as a third tier, also ran video delivery service. But if they continue to show up, think about it. We're in the age of the new big three. These are the big three content producers out there. I guess YouTube. YouTube's offended that I didn't include them. But the important thing is I do agree that the second thing, too, is the Wii U with the addition of HD video is a very big deal. I was talking about my parents. I went through setting them up with Netflix. They used Netflix on their Wii for about a week. And then they're like, yeah, it works, but everything looks crappy on it because it's got those low definition thingies. You know, they didn't even know how to express it. And so that's why I set it up again for them on the PS3. And I'm glad that Wii is getting over that fidelity hump where, which would be an awesome band name, by the way. Fidelity hump.
Fidelity hump. Aren't they opening for brown liquor this Friday at the hole in the wall?
Yes, exactly. Fidelity dump.
We don't have a whole lot more details about the Wii U. I was hoping we would by this time. The keynote's still going on as we're doing the show. But yeah, you're going to get the big three, like Brian said. Let's move on to another big story.
Tuck in your bootstraps. It's yet another big story.
Last week at D All Things Digital, a conference that's held for a bunch of tech luminaries, Ari Emanuel, a Hollywood agent, top Hollywood agent, who was the inspiration for the character Ari Gold on Entourage, took Google to task on stage saying, look, you guys need to fight piracy. How come you can fight child porn and not piracy? In a later interview, two representatives from Google went on stage and said, he's misinformed. It is different fighting copyright. You can't just look at something and say, oh, that's copyright infringement, because you have to find out who the owner is, and you have to find out if it's fair use, and you have to find out context, and was it licensed, even if you're not the owner. Whereas child porn, you can tell pretty carefully, pretty easily, whether it's child porn or not, and remove it from a search index listing. So Ari Emanuel wrote back a blog post responding, saying, I am misinformed about a lot, just ask my wife, but I'm not misinformed about this. One of our last remaining dominant American exports is our creativity, no matter how you define it, either as a story or as an algorithm. There is equal genius behind companies like Apple, Facebook, Amazon, and Google as there is behind artists who create stories that resonate around the world. We need to protect America's intellectual property, and Hollywood can't do it on its own. I understand that the onus is not entirely Google's, but let's stop talking at each other and get in a room with all the parties to figure this out. To be clear, I don't want to rehash SOPA, as we can all agree that was a reflection of Southern California's arrogance. And let's also not pretend that we're working together on this issue because we have YouTube channels together. This is a larger conversation. It's time for Hollywood, our government, and Silicon Valley to step up and collectively resolve this problem. Let me know where and when, and I'll be there.
I don't even know where to begin. I mean, I don't what define the problem and define the solution. Is the problem that piracy exists? And to him, the solution is, I don't know, do your techno wizardry and then piracy goes away. If so, that's an asinine position. There's no way that's going to happen. And there's no amount of being locked in a room together that's just going to like, come on, people, think. Let's stop this piracy thing, because there's 20th percentiles of profits that we're not squeezing out of this. I don't understand. It's making me mad thinking about it, to be honest.
It's actually, you know, here's the thing. It's a very well thought out post. It's actually the right thing to say if there's a problem. Hey, come on. Let's get together, guys. You guys have issues. We have issues. Let's work them out. I love the tone. I love the rhetoric. I think it's well written, but it makes the same mistake that every discussion about copyright is making, which it doesn't define the problem. You nailed it. The first thing out of your mouth, what actually is the problem? And the thing is, when you ask that question, a lot of people jump to the conclusion that you mean there isn't a problem and we should just let piracy run rampant and we're all that everything should be free and we're hippies, take off your shoes, put on your sandals, let down your hair and put on some beads. That is not what we're saying in any way. What we're saying is, let's define the actual problem. What's the harm we're trying to solve for? Because when you keep that amorphous, you end up with things like SOPA, which Emanuel admits was a bad idea because you're overcorrecting. But if we don't actually start with figuring out, is there copyright harm? If there is, how much is it? We can't figure out what the solution is.
Yeah, I think you made clear to me why I got mad. You're right. The letter is elegant. It's a let's get together as a team. It's got the right spirit, but it's all based on this foundation that is utter crap. It's utter crap, and it's ill-defined. And this is the reason that we're led astray is because we assume it's one of those. Well, everybody knows that piracy is a giant scourge that's taking all of our profits. So therefore, blah, blah, blah. And you can't start with that. You can't start with unsubstantiated crap like that. And that is what makes me really mad.
Yep, I agree. We could beat this story down. I don't disagree with Ari Emanuel on anything else that he wrote in that post. I think he's absolutely right that there is a there probably is a problem of some sort. And that everybody should stop finger pointing and get together and figure it out. But the place to start is figuring out what the actual problem is, which nobody has done yet.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, let's take a break and thank one of our sponsors for today's show, Squarespace.com.
Never heard of them. They sound fantastic, though. What do they do?
I talk to you about them all the time, Brian. They're fast, easy way to start a website. You just put in a name. You don't even have to give them a credit card or anything. You just put them a name. Boom. You got yourself a website. A good-looking website, too.
So you're saying I could try it out for free right now?
Yeah, actually. You go to squarespace.com right now, and you could create any blog. Your blog, hug it out.
Here's the problem, Tom. I'm not good with your HTML.
I don't need to be.
What?
Don't need to know a thing about HTML.
Wait, I mean, I don't have to use what was the Microsoft HTML in?
Front page? No.
Yeah, there you go.
You don't have to use Front Page or Page Maker or Netscape Composer. You can just go in and pick a template, and it looks beautiful. Now, if you start to learn about that stuff, you can tweak it to your heart's desire. But
here's the problem, Tom. A guy like me, especially now that I'm wearing this mustache in honor of Richard Dawson, who passed away, I expect with the moment I post my blog, portfolio, or other kind of website, it's going to be incredibly popular. I'm just going to crash the server, so I better not even try.
Well, that's the nice thing about Squarespace is you're not running your own server. You're not dealing with a hosting company that wants to charge you more and more and more. Squarespace scales to meet your demand. They take care of all that stuff for you.
Oh, my gosh. Well, I guess I'll give it a try.
You know what? And June is the best time ever to sign up for a new account, especially for annual plans, where you get a free domain name. So it's their lowest price ever. Additional 10% off with the code I'm going to give you in a minute, and a free domain name. Squarespace offering free domain registration to all annual plan customers that is completely integrated within the sign-up process. So it's hassle-free. Squarespace recently reduced its prices as low as $8 a month. But you might want to think about signing up for a year because Squarespace is giving 10% off your first purchase on new accounts. So that means 10% off your first month if you do a monthly plan, or 10% off your entire first year if you do an annual plan. Go sign up for a free account right now. You don't have to pay anything to try it out. Just no credit card or anything. Start building a website. If you do decide to purchase it, use this offer code, FRAMERATE6. That's the offer code. There's Sword and Laser right there. That's what
Look at
we
that.
Use Squarespace. There's the Ernie Cline bonus interview from Sword and Laser. Your site can look like these sites, so check it out, squarespace.com. We thank them for their support.
Oh, wait a minute. That's my site. I just remembered. I've been a client of Squarespace for like 3 years, and I love it.
It's
now
okay.
It makes sense.
You know,
that
sounds You, know. You get a lot of head injuries doing magic. I understand.
It's just a lot up here, you know?
Yeah. You got a lot going on up there. You do. That's true. That sounded disingenuous the way I said it. Now I feel bad. Oh, you've got a lot going on up there. I was not being ironic.
Yes, you do, Brian. You're always thinking those thoughts, aren't you? Big thoughts. You're going to tackle the world one day, kiddo.
Help, take us to the slipstream. Go, go, go. Show it. A bunch of stuff. It's mostly slipstream news this week. Amazon-owned Love Film, which is sort of the Netflix of Europe, although they do have Netflix in the UK, has signed a streaming deal with NBC Universal. So Amazon, this is just one of those like signposts on the road. Amazon signing deals with all kinds of people. In this case, it's for Love Film, not for Amazon Prime. But, you know, if you're in Europe, you can watch Nanny McPhee Returns now.
Thank goodness.
And Green Zone, and Bridesmaids, and Johnny English Reborn.
I like Nanny McPhee.
Actually, Snow White and the Huntsman will be coming, as will Bourne Legacy, once they actually get out of the theaters.
Oh, that's right. Did you go see Snow White and the Huntsman?
Yeah, we'll talk about that and what we're watching. I did, and I have thoughts.
All right, good. All right, we'll save it. We'll save it for that then.
Last week, Aereo went into court. Really not much to say other than the broadcaster said exactly what we thought they
would say. What are you kidding me? Not much to say. Here's like, ladies and gentlemen, the battle for supremacy of the airwaves is on. Aereo! Come on, man. This is the biggest fight. This is going to establish that you are allowed to use technology for the reasonable region-locked viewership on a device of your own choosing without having to do it all yourself. Somebody just waved the flag. It's on now. Somebody rang the bell. They're boxing now.
Yeah, I'm totally with you. Absolutely 100% agree. I'm just saying not much has happened yet. They're still kind of just circling around. You know, we expected a few test jabs. That's what's happened.
All right.
Because the broadcasters have said, look, they're retransmitting. And you can't retransmit without permission, so they have to pay. They're taking advertising revenue from us, which is debatable. I mean, you can still get a Nielsen rating out of somebody using Aereo, but they haven't set up that part of the ratings process yet. So they have a temporary argument there.
How many of these issues go away if Nielsen changes their act and gets it together? I'm going to diverge here real quick and talk about somebody had sent us an email over at framerate at twit.tv. I'm going to see if I can log in and get it. But it's to a comedian who was talking about the nature of Nielsen ratings and about how we just don't know and about how the radio kind of revolutionized things with the, was it the people meter? It's this little thing that you keep on you that just listens. And when it hears you listen to the radio, it figures out what station you're listening to and then and logs it appropriately. And there's problems with it. Obviously, if you walk by somebody else's radio, it logs it on there. But they found shocking information. For example, oldie stations were thought to be dead, but then people started wearing the people meter because people weren't reporting that they listened to oldie stations. But it turns out secretly they were. And now all of a sudden you got stations that are playing the Beatles again. And we need that kind of transformation in the video world as well, because if we had that, if we're watching how many people are watching what and when, because we don't know how many people are in the room for a lot of the Nielsen stuff, then all of a sudden it just becomes moot. And all these guys can relax about whether you're watching it on your phone or your desktop or your television in the living room, because they're going to get paid regardless.
I have a lot of problems with that, because, yes, there are issues with the way Nielsen collects their information and with the way they weight it. But Nielsen, I have always felt, does a much better job than Arbitron, and there's huge issues with the people meter. It's a huge controversy in the marketplace because it has its own biases. It has its own issues with not reporting correctly and not accurately representing what the people were actually listening to, even when they were listening to. In fact, that oldies, some people make the opposite argument that we know oldies stations are dying from other valid ways of surveying. And so the fact that people meters are showing a high listenership makes me question whether the people meters are accurate or not. Arbitron, I would not hold Arbitron up as an example to Nielsen. And Nielsen does tell you, like, who's in the room. They have a check-in system. It's not perfect. But granted, I don't want to come off as a Nielsen defender and say, oh, Nielsen's perfect. But I think it's easy to point and say, oh, Nielsen ratings are totally wrong. They're not totally wrong. There are statistical problems with any kind of sampling measure, but that doesn't mean sampling measures are wrong. There's problems with the way we collect information on the internet too, even though we have a much bigger sample, because it's not weighted correctly. You have to weight things. There, you just can't go and ask every single person who exists what they're watching and accurately get it. You have to do some kind of sampling.
Well, and that's to my original point, where if Nielsen was able to more accurately target what people are watching and when they see ads, doesn't much of the complaints about Aereo just go away?
Well, that's why I'm like, what do you mean more accurately? They're very accurate. They can get more accurate, but it implies that they're totally inaccurate now, which is a perception a lot of people in the chat room have. Nielsen actually is fairly accurate. The problem here is that Nielsen doesn't take into account Aereo. Right? If I'm watching video on the computer, Nielsen intentionally says, we don't count that the same way because it's different advertisers, it's a different time. We had to do this whole process to get DVRs accurately counted. If we just said, okay, we'll start counting Aereo like a people meter, there would be problems with that for advertisers because they'd want to know, well, what situation was this person in? Were they actually paying attention? Were they in their living room? Were they working on something else? Was it just running in the background? There's lots of reasons why you say, well, we need to know what we're measuring when. And Nielsen hasn't gotten that done yet. It doesn't mean they're not going to get that done. In fact, they will have to get that done, especially if Aereo wins this case. But bringing it back to this case, what CBS is saying is, we don't make any revenue off of somebody who watches the ads off of Aereo because it's not counted by Nielsen. And the fact of the matter is, it will be eventually. That's a solvable problem. And it has nothing to do with Nielsen's methodology or accuracy.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We've got 4K TVs being trialed by one UK broadcaster. Are you excited?
Yeah. Although we've talked about this previously, and you and I are of different minds on this. I feel like for television viewing, the difference between HD and or 1080p and 4K is small enough and subtle enough that I don't think consumers will flock to it for a television. But if you were to market the exact same thing as something brand new that had never been done before, call it, stop calling it a TV, start calling it a video wall, and start selling people on the ideas that it's not just for television and entertainment viewing, but instead it's for, now you've got virtual windows out to any location in the entire world, I think it would do better. And it's sort of bolstered by this story here where the study that they're doing is whether or not people can even recognize the difference between 1080p and 4K. And I don't think a lot of them will or care. for the most part.
I disagree. I think this is the right thing to do. This UK broadcaster is recording some content in 4K and then showing it to prospective viewers and saying, okay, which one looks better? Can you tell the difference? Is there enough of a difference that you like it? I think they will. I don't think it's like 3D where we go, oh, I don't like it. I mean, I think this is like HD was in 1998. I think you look at it and you say, wow, that's incredible. And we get used to it. But I think it's a significant difference.
Yeah, I think that you need to put it in a different category than traditional TV watching, because already there, to be honest, and I'm almost ashamed to admit this, when they installed my new box for Time Warner, because I wanted to upgrade my service and switch my DVR over for Game of Thrones, I watched the first two Game of Thrones episodes not realizing that my box was outputting 480p to my high-definition television. I thought, like, that's not as good as I remember it. Oh, well. And it didn't occur to me to go into the settings and change it. And that's for standard definition to high definition. And it's like you're looking at a much smaller, much more incremental difference from 1080p to 4K. It's not going to be nearly as stunning a leap. And for traditional
television. Have you seen 4K?
Every time I go to the movie theater. I mean, it's like
have you seen a 4K television? Have you seen video in 4K on a television?
No, not on a television. But I mean, it's the same. It's the same thing when I go to the movie theater. That's a 4K projector, and I don't know that it's that much better than 1080p that I would spend $2,000 on.
A 4K projector on a big movie screen is going to look different than a 1920 by 1080 signal on your 50-inch television.
Sure,
I've seen them at CES, and I was impressed. But maybe I'm caught up in the hype. I don't know.
It's sort of that retina display thing where it's like at a certain distance, your eye can't perceive the difference between the two. So if I'm sitting 15 feet away from my television and I have like a 47-inch display and I'm watching 1080p, if it flipped automatically to 4K from that distance, I don't know that I could tell the difference between the two.
I can. I think I can. All right. I'm the little engine that could.
And keep in mind, there's the question of whether or not you can really see it at that distance. And then there's also the question of whether or not you would pay $4,000 for the opportunity and watch limited content that's broadcast in that format.
Well, and that's the broadcast is another big question, because to get that signal, which is four times as big as a 1080p signal over the air, you're going to have to compress the hell out of it. In fact, that's the quote from this article. So that could make the point moot. If it's so compressed that you're like, actually, it looks pretty crappy.
Well, and that's the funny part, too. And they even say in the article that to deliver it, they're going to have to compress the hell out of it. So, and I've said this before, but I actually think the real opportunity for 4K displays, I think people will think they're pushing television, but then what'll happen is geeks like me are all going to buy it. And if I could have, right now, I'm looking at four monitors right now, including a 37-inch 1080p display. If I could just have something just as massive as these four monitors in front of me, but have it all just be in 4K on one display, that's what I would totally go for.
And don't forget, it's not just how good it looks to your eye resolution-wise, it's what they can capture and post-process, too. It gives them more flexibility when they shoot at 4K and know that they can broadcast in 4K than when they have to downgrade it to 1080p.
That's a really good point.
Finally, Netflix, just a note, Netflix 2.2 for iOS has a new player interface, easy to access options. That's just good to know. Netflix also now the biggest online movie business. They have passed iTunes as far as the largest provider of video online.
So tell me this. When I first read this, for some reason, there's something about the closed nature of the way iTunes handles its media that made me feel like, yeah, they stuck it to the man. But then I immediately thought, wait a minute, new boss, same as the old boss. Is there any reason to necessarily care about Netflix being number one over iTunes outside of a validation of the all-you-can-eat video model?
Yeah, this is not a consumer-related victory. Just notable that, you know what, we thought Netflix was going to be dead after Quickster and everybody's going to quit Netflix and nobody's going to use it anymore. And what this says is, you know what, according to IHS, Netflix share of the online movie market jumped to 44% in 2011. Comparatively, Apple's fell from 60.8% to 32.3%. So people like the streaming over the downloading.
Yeah, sure. Well, and also a chat room is pointing out that you could at least cheer the fact that Netflix isn't tied to specific hardware and it is open. And that's one of the things we like about Netflix is that you can watch it on so many different devices and start it on one device and then pick it up on another device.
Now, every time we talk about streaming movies, streaming TV, anything, everyone brings up bandwidth caps. How are we gonna pay? Everybody's trying to make Netflix pay. Netflix announced yesterday that it is rolling its own content delivery network. It is actually becoming a CDN. That may not mean something to everybody, but essentially they are creating their own portion of the internet to deliver their service directly to the ISPs. So instead, the way it works now, usually a content provider sends its traffic to a backbone provider, and the backbone provider transits it to the ISPs. Peering arrangements usually keep that from being necessary for the content provider to pay anything to send, because the ISPs are peering with the backbone providers. However, there has been a conflict at least once between Comcast and a provider called Level 3, where Comcast charged Level 3 for Netflix delivery. And what Comcast suggested was Level 3 isn't just transiting the content. They're actually a content delivery network. Netflix is using them to host the content. And so if they want access to our customers, they need to pay for our edge network access. Now, that may all sound like gobbledygook to you, but in the end, what it means is Netflix has now said, fine, that's the way you're going to treat it. We're going to be a content delivery network. We're going to deliver our traffic directly to the ISPs. And in fact, we'll set up hardware at the ISPs so they can cache the entire Netflix library, deliver it within the network, and then it doesn't have to be transited at all. You don't have to pay anybody. It'll just be there inside your own network.
Yeah, that all sounds completely rad. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's good stuff. Let's move on to the tube tops. Simple TV has a Kickstarter campaign. We've talked about Simple TV before. It wants to help you access broadcast TV wherever you are, but also hook up your streaming devices like your Roku box or your Xbox, and have an over-the-air antenna, all with a DVR and Slingbox-like features. And they've got a Kickstarter campaign. If you pledge $25 or more, you get a T-shirt. $125 or more, you get the DVR at a $25 discount. $150, you actually get the Simple TV box when it's made and a year of service, and then the prices go up from there.
I'll tell you, I showed this to Bonnie, and you know, it's one thing for all us tech heads to get excited about these devices, but it's another thing to take somebody who isn't really interested in the mechanics of it and get them excited about it. Bonnie watched this Kickstarter, and she was way excited about it. The moment this comes out, I got the go-ahead, we're going to cut the cord, and the kids, we're just going to... The only thing I don't like about it is it's got that same problem with you have to know what you want to watch in advance, days in advance of it, to set up the DVR capability. And now that I've had a taste of Hulu's On Demand Anytime Anywhere, it sort of has taken the shine off of DVRs in general for me. Or, I mean, do you find it that way, or you don't mind setting those things up in advance?
No, I'm getting tired of, you know, it's funny. It's like when the DVR came along, it was like, oh, thank goodness you don't have to deal with tapes and setting a clock and swapping things out and accidentally recording over other things. The DVR just handles it all. You can set your schedule. Then we go crazy setting the schedule because it becomes easy.
Sure.
And now we're like, oh, man, I keep forgetting to set season passes and cancel them, and it creates a whole suite of new problems. And it doesn't have to be that way. We could, and Hulu and Netflix and Amazon all show that what we really want is to be able to just watch the next episode of whatever it is. And we need the service to tell us what the next episode of whatever it is, like Netflix does, right? When you're watching through a season, it says, oh, okay, you've watched these five. Here's
now
the next one.
Now, think about this. What if there was a DVR that offered kind of a predictive service that sort of just made a best guess? Like, you know what? You
TiVo did that.
What? But like it automatically, I mean, TiVo did it based on how much room you had left in there. I know, I guess you're right. I mean, TiVo did exactly what I wanted to do. How weird is it that 15 years after the launch of TiVo, I'm asking for TiVo-like services from my DVR?
Well, I think essentially what you want is no DVR. You want to just be able to access, you want a service that says, here are all the shows. You can bookmark the shows you like, and we'll send you alerts when there's a new episode. But otherwise, you can access any show anytime you want. You don't have to have set it up to record.
Right. And specifically, I think what you and I are both talking about is we want the ability to discover a show after we missed its premiere, you know, and there's no way to do that with traditional DVRs. The only way you could do it is if you had a TiVo-like thing where it's like, well, I figured you might like this, so I went ahead and recorded it for you, and you could discover that for the fact.
Or it changes channels. Sometimes that happens, and then suddenly the season pass doesn't work, stuff like that. You want to avoid all of that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Infinitech was a company we saw at CES with a product that was a USB stick that you would plug into the back of your TV, and then you would get infinite storage, or your back of your PC, get infinite storage. In other words, you'd be able to store as many TV shows as you want. It was not seamless in its operation. It's a Dubai-based outfit. The new product is now an Android-based HDMI dongle. It's being called Pocket TV, and you plug this into your television, you'll be able to Skype from the big screen, show PowerPoint presentations without a laptop connection, and tap into files you've hosted on Dropbox, and it'll ship with a gyro-equipped keyboard remote that allows control by your hand motions. So,
man, this is all over the map, because as you describe those features, I thought of three totally different consumers. I pictured, you know, one is the businessman who wants to be able to make his presentation easily by just plugging it into any television. Then I think of a consumer doing their thing. It's how are they going to market this?
Good question. I think they're going to market it as like, your television could be internet connection in a snap, because you just plug this into the HDMI port. It connects over Wi-Fi, which I think is going to be an issue for things like Skype, but whatever. And it's going to be able to stream some TV. It's going to be able to access video from Dropbox, access files from Dropbox. I think it's not going to do enough television stuff. There is a YouTube app on there. There's some game apps on there, et cetera. I just don't think it's going to do enough. But at $99, you could buy a Roku, although I guess this is easier to set up.
Yeah, well, and it depends. It's the mobility of it that matters. And that's the reason I think of the traveling guy making sales pitches and wants to be able to just plug.
Yeah, right. That's true.
It's got to focus on the mobility of it.
Version 1.6 of ATV Flash is now out. That's a $30 package that you can use to jailbreak your Apple TV. Well, you have to jailbreak your Apple TV, and then you install it on your jailbroken Apple TV. It adds more codecs, more languages, smoother video playback, better networking, and they will upgrade you to Apple TV's third generation functionality automatically whenever that rolls out.
Yeah. Hey, man, I know we have to take a break to listen to our sponsors. And while you talk about the sponsors, I'm going to run and check on my 4-year-old because I'm supposed to be watching her while I'm doing this show.
All right. That sounds like a good plan.
Awesome.
You know, one thing you can do to help take care of your 4-year-old is put on Netflix with their favorite shows. In fact, I know Brian does that sometimes. Netflix is a sponsor of Framerate today and is offering you a free 30-day trial. So if you hear us talking about Netflix, and you're like, you know, I'd like to try that out, you can try it out for free for 30 days. Netflix.com/twit. Instead of paying, try it out for free. You can stream unlimited amounts of movies and TV shows to all kinds of devices, game consoles, PCs, phones, tablets, what have you. If you're already a Netflix subscriber or you don't want to be a Netflix subscriber, but you know somebody who does, then pass along this URL, netflix.com.
Tom, you're not going to believe it. Tom, I just walked out. Like, I heard her knock on the studio door, and I was nervous that something was wrong. I walk out, and I look over the banister, and there she is. She went and enabled the Xbox and found Fishtronaut, and she's watching cartoons right now on Netflix.
That's how what I just said. It's perfect.
It's awesome.
That's great. All right, let's move on to Film Found. Film Found! George Lucas is planning his retirement. And we don't just mean like he's picked new 401k options. He's actually naming an heir. Handpicked longtime Hollywood producer Kathleen Kennedy is now co-chair, or will become shortly, co-chair of Lucasfilm, according to a press release earlier this week.
I'm going to be very good here, Tom, and just say that I look forward to the interesting opportunities within the Star Wars intellectual property under someone else's guidance.
Strike him down and he will only become more powerful.
I didn't say that. I didn't talk about how George Lucas ruined my favorite IP. And I didn't talk about, I'm not even going to do this snarky thing where I say things without saying them. All I'm going to say is I'm very excited that there's some fresh blood, because it's obvious that we love, and I say we, I mean the world, loves the Star Wars universe. I think that for the last decade, it's really lost its way. And I really look forward to the interesting stories that can be told within this universe if there's somebody who's not so possessive and up close to it.
Well, she is taking over Lucasfilm, not particularly the Star Wars franchise.
So don't care about anything. I don't care about anything but Star Wars.
Maybe she doesn't either. I don't know.
Yeah.
Big thanks to Rabbit Badger who sent along this next thing. It's from My Damn Channel. Mark Malkoff took a challenge to watch over 250 movies on Netflix streaming in 1 month. And he has a 4-minute video showing him doing just that.
Does he pull it off? Does he get all of them done?
Yeah, according to the video, he does. Now, it's all edited together. Obviously, he could have easily faked it, but I don't think he did. I mean, he looks pretty tired at one point. And there's some nice shtick where his wife is talking about how it's ruining their relationship because he's trying to watch all these movies. He talks about how he misses audio commentary from DVDs. And so he brings in actors to sit on the couch with him and give him commentary.
That is awesome. This is almost, it almost sounds like we're still doing our sponsor read for Netflix, because one of the things his point is, he says, if you watch 100 movies, you're getting them for 8 cents a pop. But he says, his whole goal was to get it as cheap as possible. So think about these movies, 3.5 cents each he's watching them for?
Yeah, if you skip to the end, Chad, I think we'll get close to where he tells how much he ended up spending, but it's like a few cents per movie.
That's awesome.
That was too far.
Chad.
Yeah.
Point is, it's a cool experiment that he's doing.
Yeah, day 23 was at 4.5 cents per movie, so he got even. If you go, there he is with the guy from St. Elmo's Fire.
That's awesome.
He's watching on his iPhone. And then at the end, he asks him, "Can you give me commentary on Weekend at Bernie's?" And the guy's like, "No, I got things to do. Get out of here."
Yeah,
that's a pretty funny video. And he lists all 252 movies that he watched.
You know what? In the chat room, I got a question that just popped up. Tom HMB says, "I don't understand this simple TV." Talking about what we talked about in Tube Tops, he says, "How are you cutting the cord?" We neglected to mention that it does it by grabbing it all over the air, which is 100% free. And
either over the air or over the internet.
Yeah. Or I guess you could.
Because it does streaming pass-through, so it can send your Roku signal through the Simple TV.
Right. Okay. Yeah, that's why. I mean, it's the very definition of cord cutting, and you should watch that video.
Yeah. Definitely check it out. Let's move on to the summer movie draft that I'm winning.
Go.
Snow White and the Huntsman, it was Scott Johnson's movie, made $56 million, very respectable. Brian, your movie, Men in Black 3, is now up to $111 million, putting you in third place. You're on the heels of Scott, but I'm still in front because of the Avengers.
Still not as fast as, it's just going to taper off from here, which it means it looks like just about all four of my movies are underperforming expectations, which means I'm certainly out of it for the big thing. As we mentioned last week, the only thing I care about is winning my side stake bet with Justin, though. I'm up to around $290 million for those four movies during this month. And if they could just make $50 million, $60 million more dollars, then it got me a tasty steak.
Well, this week you've got Madagascar.
Yeah.
Now, as far as do pretty well.
Yeah.
It's Madagascar 3, but...
Yeah, it will do extremely well on a per dollar basis, because remember, I only spent $18 for Madagascar, but I there's no way I could catch up to everyone. I mean,
how much would you need? Well, no, I don't know if you can catch up with Scott or me at $568 million. But Madagascar 3 could win you your side bet, is what I'm thinking.
No, that's out of the side bet. The side bet was
I see, because it's just in June.
Yeah, right. that my four movies in May total would not hit $357 million. So we'll see.
Yeah, that may be tight. Also out, Veronica's movie, Prometheus, which I'm very excited about. Yes. I'm definitely going to go watch this.
Dude, the early reviews have been phenomenal. And they say, don't even bother watching anything from the Alien franchise was what I read. But
No, I don't think you have to enjoy it, but I wanted to, so I did. just in case, just so I can piece it together. But they're going out of their way to say this is not a prequel to Alien. It just happens to exist in the same universe.
Yeah, well, and that's great. And it's, oh, I'm just so excited. It looks awesome.
Well, speaking of what we're going to watch, let's talk about what we have watched.
What we're watching.
So I went to see Snow White and the Huntsman this weekend. My wife's a huge Snow White fan, and we were both excited to see it. I thought it looked great, a nice dark tale, dark reimagining, if you will, or actually more true to the original grim fairy tale with Charlize Theron. The positives, I could say, Kristen Stewart did a great job in the first half of the movie. Charlize Theron knocked it out of the park. Most of the acting was good. It was gorgeous. It looked absolutely beautiful. The visual effects were pretty good as well, but it just fell flat. Kristen Stewart played it too vulnerable towards the end, and I didn't believe her transformation into the strong Joan of Arc-like Snow White that they showed towards the end of the movie. And I just kept thinking, I should enjoy this more. It didn't bring the dramatic tension. They just kind of seemed to blow through all of the big payoff points.
That's a bummer. So would you say it's an overall thumbs up or thumbs down? If you had to call it, like, go see it or don't go see it.
I hate to go thumbs down, but I think I'd go thumbs down.
So, like, if you were going to tell someone, go see Snow White or go see The Avengers for a second time, you would say...
I might even say see The Avengers for a third time. And I'm not just saying that because I own... Even if I didn't own the movie.
Yeah, sure. No. Yeah, I mean, that makes sense.
I would say go see Prometheus. That's what I would say.
Oh, God. Yeah. Yes, cannot wait for that. Absolutely.
Because there were some funny things where they set up certain stuff and then they didn't pay it off. Where you're like, wait a minute, what? There was this whole dramatic love story, right? Like the true kiss that wakes her from sleep, you know, right out of the fairy tale.
Right.
And they just kind of blew it off. Like after it happened, they're like, oh hey, is it you? Oh yeah, good to see you. All right, let's go. Like that's the resolution of the love story. That anyway. What have you been watching?
You're also watching Mad Men. Anything new happening on Mad Men?
Oh, yeah. Mad Men season finale is this coming Sunday, and they are killing it. Best season I have watched so far.
That's awesome. And, of course, we'll
talk... I just said something that is actually a horrible, horrible thing to say if you've watched this last episode.
What just happened?
I said they're killing it, and there's a character.
Oh, there. Okay. All right. that was a spoiler. Well, now it became a spoiler.
I know, right?
Spoiler
alert. Anyway, so
you should have just let it go.
What have you been watching?
I've been watching this, the Scam School Book 2.
Nice.
I've done nothing but work on Scam School Book 2. Let me just say, I'm very, very excited about it. It's very, very good. It's going to be so much bigger. There's almost twice the number of videos in Book 2 over Book 1. Hours of commentary, tracks on there. This will be the Empire Strikes Back of the trilogy. I'm very excited about it. But did make time to watch just Korra, which continues to be completely awesome, and Game of Thrones, which I'm sure we'll talk about.
Yeah, we'll talk about Game of Thrones in the spoiler zone. So let's get to feedback.
Now it's time for feedback with Brian and Tom on Frame Rate. Oh, yeah.
We start with an audio question, Brian.
Yeah, let's go ahead and roll this audio, Chad.
Hey guys, this is Will from Tampa. I just want to know why Brian doesn't like channel numbers. I mean, it's so simple. Take DirecTV for instance. All your local channels are between 3 and 70. All the 100s are your pay-per-view. All the 200s are your entertainment. All the 300s are your information. All the 400s are your Spanish channels, except for the end of the 400s, which are your Chinese channels, and that's only Cantonese. So if you want Mandarin, you have to go to the 2000s, and then you have all your 500s or your premium movie channels. 600s are your sports channels, except for ESPN, which is in the 200s, and the NFL networks and tennis and golf and baseball and basketball. And then you have your 700s are your subscription sports channels. 800s are your music channels. 1000s are your on-demand channels, which are really easy because you just add a 1 to the number of the cable channel you want to watch. For instance, USA is on 242, so for USA On Demand, you go to 1242, and simple as that. What could be easier?
I loved this.
Yeah, it's that easy, Brian.
It really was. It's totally simple. That was from William Mosley, by the way. Thank you so much, Will. Luke writes in and says, hey, Frame Rate, Tom and Brian, on episode 78, a listener/viewer of the show emailed about suggestions for an internet set-top box and where to find comparisons on the many different models. To help out with this problem, about a year ago, your friend Veronica Belmont started a Google Doc that was left open for users to add and edit the ever-changing field of such devices. Hope this helps. Luke from Charlotte, North Carolina, and you're taking a look at it right now. I guess she did this for Techzilla, and I love the fact that the fans just ran with it and continue to keep it updated.
It needs to have the Apple TV added to it. That's true. I can't believe they're still keeping it up to date. That's awesome.
Yeah, no, I love that's one of the things. And of course, you know, that's a big part of what Twit's founded on is this active community taking part in it. It's good to see on the internet all that stuff happening.
Yeah, thanks for that. And thank you, Veronica.
And we'll put that link in the show notes as well.
All right. Do we want to get to the spoiler zone or do we want to read one more piece of feedback?
We got plenty of time for a spoiler zone. We can do another feedback.
All right. Let's go with this one from Rinnis, who says, responding to the email from the guy who was denied internet from AT&T, I'm sure you got millions of emails that give a more technical explanation, but here goes. This exact thing happened to a friend of mine who moved to a small town and wanted to get DSL. Here in South Africa, we only have DSL. And worse, only one DSL provider. While we have many ISP choices, the wires are controlled by the National Telecoms Company. To get to your confusion, the exchange boxes outside each neighborhood that connects the home to the larger DSL network can only handle a finite amount of connections. In many cases, this number is lower than the number of consumers in the area. It is thus perfectly possible that your neighbor can have service, but he occupies one of the used connections, and that there is no more connection left for you. The only options are waiting for the provider to upgrade the hardware on the exchange, and sometimes they're unwilling to do this for just one user, or wait until someone drops their service and a connection opens up. Thanks, Rinnis.
Yeah, man. Fantastic. I love the fact that we have viewers that are way smarter than us.
And you know what? I should have known this because I knew that DSL was not shared bandwidth over the local loop, that you get an individual channel. So that makes sense that they would only have a limited number of connections that they would want to allow.
Yeah, right on. Dude, are we ready to wrap things up and start getting spoilery up in this?
I think we are. Thanks, everybody, for watching or listening. If you don't want to be spoiled on Game of Thrones and only Game of Thrones, we're not going to throw in two this week. It's just the GOT talk. The finale was this past week. You either turn off your live stream or mute it or stop your download, stop playing your download, whatever you need to do.
Fair your fingers warning. In the ears and go la 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 for the next 10 minutes.
It's going to happen as soon as we roll these end credits. Thanks everybody for watching or listening. You can find us on the web at twit.tv/FR. We got a schedule change. We're going to start streaming on Mondays at 3 p.m. in July, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern. But until then, we're on at 10 a.m. Pacific on Tuesdays. And you can email us, framerate@twit.tv. We'll see you later. So, Brian.
All right.
Let's go right to the chase. Karth.
Oh, loved it. Loved everything.
Oh, good.
I'm 100% happy with everything. Make changes. Here's the thing, and to remind everyone, I was not unhappy with where it diverged from the book. I was nervous. And as one of the readers sent in or the viewers sent in to us, it's like there are certain beats they need to hit. There are certain places they need to get there. And if they take a shortcut from where they went in the book, then as long as you still hit that place, it's fine. And I totally kept that in mind, took it to heart, loved what happened with Karth. You know, you change the motivations a little bit for why it happens, but it was a great, and I don't even mind that with her handmaidens now all dealt with, they're all gone. It changes little things about the books. But I don't care. I don't care. I'm in love with everything. Loved Karth. What about you?
I was the only thing I was worried about when they went to the vault.
Yeah.
And then threw the handmaiden in.
Yeah.
I was like, uh-oh, Brian's going to be pissed.
No.
There goes another handmaiden.
I don't care. It was way too happy. And I don't think that moment of pulling open an empty vault, I don't even think there was an analog to that in the book. I mean,
exactly.
Zeroes of Nexus was powerful and was rich in the book. But I liked that kind of...
he's still around in the books. I don't want to get too spoilery book-wise, but...
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, I didn't mind any of that. Also, you realize that in... And again, memories are fuzzy, right? Let's talk about the ending with what happened north of the wall. The entire big battle at the in book three was not the whites coming rolling forward. It was the wildlings, right? But they clearly indicate that it's going to be the whites that they're fighting here. How do you feel about that?
Now, when they're on that hilltop in the book, I thought, and this may be my memory failing, that at night they did get attacked by the walkers.
Well, I mean, they did get attacked by it, but like the fact that you see this army walking towards the wall, I don't see any way from a television perspective that could be your cliffhanger for season two. And then in season three, say, yeah, but that was a minor skirmish. The real battle is with the wildlings that we're fighting. You see what I mean?
Well, like, I think what you do is you have it be two battles. So the White Walkers show up, and essentially what they've set up is that he's going to warn them that you'll need obsidian. I found all these blades. Use these blades. They'll fight them off, and then they'll have to fight the wildlings. And then we're going to see Jon Snow involved.
Did you... were you surprised that they set up the dragon glass with the obsidian two episodes ago, and then they didn't bother to have Sam accidentally kill a white?
Yeah, I know. I guess they're just saving that because they don't want you to forget. So they want to emphasize. He's probably going to kill one now where he's hiding behind the rock. And then
yeah, it'll probably be in the first episode. Yeah. And again, minor changes that I don't mind. How do you feel about the fact that they're in... We'll have to talk about whether or not this is confirmed or not, but at some point I remember hearing that book two or book three is going to be split into two seasons. Is that right?
Yeah, that's what I've heard. I don't know. I mean, I'm not George R. R. Martin, so I can't confirm, but that's what I've read too. I'm George R. R. Martin.
I knew it.
And I can confirm they're splitting it into two seasons. No, yeah, that's everything I've read has indicated that as well. Which, if you're Martin, that's smart, right? I need more time to finish those books before we catch up.
It buys you way more time to finish writing all those books. Speaking of which, I'm actually, this is George R. R. Martin related. I'm listening to the audiobooks of Wild Cards. Have you ever heard of this collection of short stories? I think it was in the 80s.
Is it sci-fi or is it?
It is sci-fi-ish.
I think I've heard of that.
Written in the 80s. It's about a virus that kills some people, gives some people superpowers, and other people makes them. It's hot and cold because it's a collection of short stories written by different people, each one with their own agenda. So there's this whole arc where somebody writes in the House Committee on Un-American Affairs, and instead of trying to hunt down communists, it's like, are you now or have you ever been a wild card, that kind of thing. About halfway through the first collection comes to George R. R. Martin's short story that he wrote. And oh my God, that guy can write. I mean, it's like night and day. I was so wrapped up in this story, and knowing it's from the same mind that brought us the world of Westeros made it all the more exciting.
Cool. I was also very excited about the way we touched on everything. You know, we got an update on everybody one last time. I felt like they nailed the season. I can't wait for the next one. And what about Tyrion's nose?
You know what? You and I both knew that there was no way they were going to mangle his face as bad as it was depicted in the book. But
they could have. They could, it'd just be a prosthesis.
Yeah, but
they're
going
to put makeup on him all the time now anyway, because he's going to have that scar.
I think the scar is grotesque enough that he really looks messed up.
I'm disappointed. Though,
are you? You wanted to see his face more messed up and hideous?
Yeah.
The problem is you're going to have... I almost got two spoilers.
Yeah.
I almost went into book spoiler territory.
Yeah. Let's try to avoid that if we can.
Yeah. Let's just say that there are problems with making him very grotesque. How about that?
I wanted him to have like a bigger gash in the middle of the nose. If you're going to compromise on that, like bridge of the nose missing.
Here's the real bummer is, I mean, he looked pretty messed up this episode, but it's a fresh wound. And I guarantee you that scar is just going to get smaller and smaller. And eventually it's going to be like Omar Little's scar, where it's like you could not even notice it.
That's what Justin and I said. I think Justin is the one who said that. He's like,
oh, really?
He's like, oh, it's like an Omar scar. I'm like, yeah, Tyrion's coming. The yeah. imp stands alone.
Lannister walking. yeah, what else? What else happened this last episode? I don't know what else to be excited about.
We talked about Daenerys. We talked to, Sansa gets her reprieve from marrying Joffrey, but now what?
For all the good that does her. And I'll tell you what. We did get one email from somebody who's saying, like, he really just hopes Sansa dies. Like, he just hates her. And, you know, I don't know if he hates her because she's weak or boring or whatever, but this is minor spoiler territory. But she gets, I think, a lot more interesting in the third book as she learns to distrust everyone in her life. And I think she becomes more sympathetic a character during that.
Also, my favorite sitcom in years, the Bree and Jamie Lannister show.
Oh my God, yes, it's going to be so good this next book. It's going to be a buddy travel comedy on the next season.
And if these early scenes are any indication, they are definitely playing it right. They've got the banter. It's working. Brienne was fantastic. The woman who plays Brienne was fantastic in that interaction with the thieves on the road, or the not thieves. I guess they're just men, freelance highwaymen.
Sure.
Yeah, it was just love that everything, and you could see Jamie starting to go, "Oh, you can fight."
All yes. Right. And also, I'll tell you what else I enjoyed. I enjoy the way they take big chunks of the book and really just give you a flavor of it. Like the way I am really surprised for as little FaceTime as we've seen with Theon Greyjoy that we just get who he is from the television show alone. He's somebody who's ambitious but weak and conflicted.
Weak rhymes with...
Yeah. Come on, you know we got rules here.
If you don't know, it doesn't do anything.
Madman is killing it. That's all I'm going to say.
All right. That's it, I think. Thank you.
Yeah, it's fantastic. I guess we'll see. One other thing to say. I forgot to mention during what we're watching, what I'm really watching is the clock as we count down the seconds to the premiere of Breaking Bad Season 5. Oh! We should have reported this in the rumor. The guy who plays Jesse Pinkman, did you see his tweet saying that season 5 will not be the end?
What?
Yeah. Somebody in the chat room is going to link this to us in about 2 seconds here so you can show it. But he says, guys, season 5 will not be our last season. Stay tuned. And it's his real life account. Now, the response I heard is that what it really means is you're going to get 8 episodes in season 5 and then 8 episodes in season 6. So you're really looking at just one season broken apart. You know, I'm sure that behind the scenes more money became available, or they decided it was worth it to keep around. But regardless, man, I'll keep Breaking Bad around as long as I could possibly see it.
Yeah. Oh, that's good news. I was thinking like, is Hulu picking it up? Is Netflix picking it up?
No. Well, I don't know. Actually, he just said, stay tuned.
No,
so
it probably just means the breaking up the episodes. Oh, well.
Yeah.
Good to know. Thanks, everybody, for watching The Spoiler Zone. Twit.tv/FR. Tell your friends.
Yeah.
See ya.
Mark 8675 says, Spoiler Zone reminds me of Spanish telenovelas. I have no idea what's happening, but it's fun to watch.
Oy! Mi madre!
Mis toques discos es descompuesto!
Me gusta.
Que película vamos a ver.
Hay 12 vacas sobre su cocina.
Toca mi mono.
Muchos ratones en mis pantalones.
Sabado gigante.